Coming up next on The Voice of Alabama Politics, Judicial Override. Also, the V-Team takes a look at impeachment restart. And some charitable organizations are asking, those ethics laws, what were we thinking?
It'll close for another hour or so. It's raining pretty hard.
I got my car. Yeah, that's right, it is, isn't it? You know, it just happened. I got a bottle of pretty good rye in my pocket. I'd a lot rather get wet in here.
Well. Looks like we're closed for the rest of the afternoon.
Now that is what I call charitable giving. All this and much, much more coming up next on The V.
The Voice of Alabama Politics with your host, Bill Brett. Now, the number one political show in Alabama, The V.
Welcome to The Voice of Alabama Politics, where we tackle the tough issues so you have the hard facts. I'm your host, Bill Britt, and as always, I'm joined by the V-Team. Welcome.
Good morning. Glad to be here.
Claire, you're heading out next week, going to the inauguration and all that stuff.
It should be all exciting and a new turn to make America great again.
Depending on who you talk to.
Well, I think it's going to help the economy. I think it's going to help business. I think it's going to do a lot of things like that.
I hope you're right. I hope you're right. One of the things that has happened lately in the state of Alabama is business elites, associations, and all of those types of groups have gathered together and got a mantra that we heard from Mike Hubbard. Those ethics laws, what were we thinking? One of the things, Chip, we learned is that they use these charitable organizations out of Birmingham as basically a stalking horse to convince the Ethics Commission to back down on an opinion that would have solidified who is the principal and who can give what to whom.
Exactly, I think that's their concern. I think they're worried that the definition of principal is a little too broad. They're worried that, you know, you couldn't give money to a charity. At least that's the way I understand it, and it might come back to bite you under the ethics laws. And I think it's funny that the same, you know, lawyers and the same people that, you know, helped Mike Hubbard out with his case are now concerned with the same laws that he helped pass when he became Speaker of the House.
So. Well, they just didn't realize what they were doing.
I don't think, they must not have. They didn't read the bill.
Yeah, well, you know.
That never happens.
You know, Claire, and I mean, it's really a serious thing that they're trying to undermine the ethics laws and the ruling of the jury. Not that it would affect Mike Hubbard, but you and I know that if they can get this done, nobody will ever go to jail under the ethics laws again.
Well, and it's unfortunate. I know that the Attorney General is coming with a packet on a strong ethics law and trying to, you know, clean up a lot of the loopholes and everything, because there's so many members in the House and Senate right now that have stepped off of committees because they thought they have a conflict of interest, which in their minds they do, and I don't blame them for doing that.
Well, some of them I certainly do. I mean, they certainly do.
I mean, that's the concern, I think, with having a citizen legislature, is you do have a lot of conflict of interest.
Well, and it seems like there's this one business organization, that the one that's trying to spearhead it, who was so much behind Mike Hubbard.
Yeah.
Is that right?
I mean, BCA is really behind it.
But if you look at the Friends of McCullough, the way it was written.
This is the charitable act.
This is a charitable act that the Ethics Commission overturned regarding principles. If you look at that verbiage very closely, you can't really see where it goes down to just a contribution level. In other words, what it said was that contribution would have had to profit the person or the spouse or whatever of the person that was collecting the contribution. If it's not profitable to them personally, then it wasn't a problem.
Well, right? Former Chief Justice Sue Bell Cobb came out this past week in an editorial or op-ed in the Alabama, whatever it's called, AL.com, mm-hmm. where she said, thank God, basically, for them striking down Friends of McCullough because it would have been devastating to the charitable community. Now, I like Judge Cobb, but she's dead wrong. All that statement meant, all that opinion meant, is that if you cannot put it in your own pocket.
Right.
It's very simple. No, that did not, that does not apply to charities the way, but they set it up, Claire. You had J. Mark White there. You had Espies. You had Hosp. You had all these attorneys that in some way were connected to Mike Hubbard.
That's right.
Or trying to overturn these bills. I mean, Hosp and them and came out right after Mike was convicted and said, mm-hmm. oh, my God, this is terrible.
Well, he wrote his own scenario and laid all this out for, you know, some business entities. And I believe, I mean, the Attorney General's office has said it's not accurate.
Well, it's not. And, I mean, this is just, if these guys had their way, Billy Canary would be sitting back in the Speaker's office and some other guy would be paying him $10,000 a month. And they run the state just like they did yeah. under Hubbard.
I think that's what they're trying to get back to. Because, you know, if you look at the way this, even the head of the Ethics Commission, I can't think of his name
yeah,
right now.
Albritton.
Stood up and said, don't do this.
Yeah.
Don't do this way. So even he sees it. But
well,
I think that's what they want to get back to.
Seems they've gotten with the program.
Right. I mean, you know, we talk about, you know, no-bid contracts, transparency in government, and then you've got people like that you've mentioned, they're trying to take it back to the days back in the closet.
Yeah.
And that's just wrong, and I think the Attorney General's office is trying to do the right thing.
And I think the case with Mike Hubbard also scared a lot of the principals, per se,
yeah.
too.
Well, sure, because it should have.
A lot of them got immunity in that case if they came forward and spoke to the Attorney General's
right.
office,
right.
and now other ones could be in a worse position,
but that
because that law affects both people.
Remember,
the
that wasn't a charitable contribution to an organization.
They weren't
that
good
was
friends
money
either.
To a,
yeah,
a principal.
To a trade association.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. We got about 2 minutes left. I want to get to this. Very conservative Republican, Dick Brubaker, always outside the box, Dick is, and he has called to end judicial override. And what that is, Susan, is where in a capital murder case, a judge can overrule what the jury gives as recommends as a verdict. The jury can say, okay, we want to give him life without parole. Judge says no, he gets death. Dick wants to do away with this.
He does want to do away with it because he's afraid that, see, the United States Supreme Court really doesn't like this sort of thing. They just reversed it in Florida, saying it was unconstitutional. Alabama's the last one standing that has judicial override. So what this does, if it stands, gives the U.S. Supreme Court the opportunity to come in here and not only kill that, but kill our death penalty statutes.
So and he's trying to protect that.
He's wanting to get ahead of that and say, you know, we just need to go. I think Delaware was another one.
They voluntarily changed
yeah.
their.
Well, you know, I'm for the yellow mama and I'm for the hammer and I think frying them up and lethal injection. But I understand what he's saying. If the jurors say this woman gets life without parole, and then the judge goes ahead and said give him the death penalty, I'm with the judge. But if in fact we're the only state in the nation that doesn't do that, then I agree with.
But also, you got to remember that a lot of these overrides are done during election periods.
Yeah, that's a statistic we saw.
Yeah.
What, 92% or
something? Since 1976, mm-hmm. there have been 107 overrides. 92% of those overrides were changing it from life without parole to the death penalty. And several of those have come back, and some of those people have been exonerated.
And while I'm all for the death penalty, but I'm not for the death penalty for somebody that didn't commit the crime.
Well, I don't believe in state-sanctioned murder, which is what it is. If you kill mm-hmm. someone who's innocent, that's just murder. Mm-hmm. That's all it
okay,
is.
Well, the deal is Brubaker's going to clear this up for us.
All yes,
right.
he is.
We're going to leave it right there. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Claire wants to hang them all.
By their toes, right?
In our ever-changing world, there are obstacles and opportunities. The future belongs to those who know. What's the big idea? At a time when it's hard to break through the noise, what's the big idea cuts through the clutter. What's the Big Idea is at the nexus of business, innovation, and politics. the place where the future is today. And what everyone will be talking about tomorrow. What's the big idea?
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Our guest today is John Merrill, Secretary of State of Alabama. Welcome.
Hey, Bill. Great to be with you, as always.
Great to have you. We seldom can use the words better, cheaper, faster in any government agency, but you have made the Secretary of State's office better, cheaper, and my Lord, it's fast.
Well, we appreciate you acknowledging that, and we think it's so important to provide the kind of customer service that people expect from retail vendors or folks that they do business with every day. What we don't want is people to have an opportunity to interact with our office and to think that we move at the speed of government. We want to move at the speed of business because that's what people expect and it's what they should demand.
You've made some significant changes, especially in the area of databases and the ability to file online to get your business license. Tell us a little bit about that and what motivated
Well, we have, but I think the thing that is the most interesting and the thing that we're the proudest of, Bill, is the fact that we've been able to reduce the business filing aspect from 7 to 9 months turnaround when we started to where we are today. We made that a priority, and we allowed the people who were in those positions to try to make that happen on their own. But we could not get it under 41 days of filing, which is 7 days in a week. So you're still 6 weeks behind. And so finally, one day, my chief, David Brewer, who came from Baldwin County and did a tremendous job as the county administrator down there and is doing an outstanding job for the people of Alabama as the chief of staff in the office of the Secretary of State, he went to the director of business services and talked to her and said, well, tell me how you physically do it when people pay the extra fee and you get it done in a day.
Right.
And she said, well, it's 3 days. And he said, no, I mean, how do you do it when they pay the extra money from intake, processing to execution? And she said, well, it's 3 days. And he said, why don't you tell me what you're talking about? And she said, well, a day is 24 hours. And she said, and David nodded his head. And then she said, and a work day is 8 hours. And he said, okay. And she said, so we have 3 work days to get it done in 1 day.
Wow.
And he said, I don't think that's what the Alabama legislature intended when they allowed us to charge that extra fee to the constituents to have it done in a day. 2 weeks later, she decided it was time for her to find something else to do. So she became one of 25 people who've left the office of the Secretary of State since January the 19th, 2015, when we took over. We had 49 employees in the office that day. Today we have 35 employees in that office. So we've replaced some of those people that have left, but I am happy to report to you that for 28 consecutive weeks, we've been at 1 day on business filings.
Wow.
Which means that if you send your check in, it's not held for 7 to 9 months like it was been held before. It's deposited that day, and your paperwork is taken care of that day.
I mean, we as business owners found that amazing. You know, I know you've had interactions with my wife, Susan. Not always positive.
Most of them positive.
Yeah, most of them positive. But, you know, she and other people that we've talked to, like our accountant, they're just amazed that it actually works.
Well, and I think it's important that people buy into what you're trying to sell. And what we tried to help our people understand is when you call the office of the Secretary of State as a constituent, as a business owner, as an attorney, as an accountant, as a common everyday citizen, you're not interrupting our day. You're not irritating us when you send us an email. You're not causing us to delay other work that we're trying to do. We work for you. We work for you in the office of the Secretary of State, and we want to make sure that people know that. So when they have concerns, they have issues, they have problems, we need to give them the kind of attention that they deserve.
Well, it certainly shows, and the attitude within the office, the people that we interact with, have all been super. And we don't praise many agencies or many departments, but we happen to do that.
Well, thank you. Yeah. And all the praise goes to the employees that work in the office of the Secretary of State. Those team members have come together. They've committed themselves to excellence and to trying to be the best that they can be to serve the people of Alabama.
Do you, let's talk about the elections. You know, we just went through the elections. It was, of course, Alabama, everything we heard went smoothly. But just tell us about the process a little bit. And what
well,
y'all
we couldn't be happier with the results. As you know, we made a committed effort to ensure that each and every eligible U.S. citizen that's a resident of the state of Alabama is registered to vote and has a photo ID. So since January the 19th, 2015, we registered more than 600,000 new voters in the state of Alabama, which is unprecedented and unparalleled in the history of our state. In March of 2016, we broke every record for turnout in the primary season. 1.2 million people participated in that process. And then on November the 8th, we broke every record for participation in the general election when we had more than 2.1 million people voted and almost 70% of the electorate participated.
That is real. I mean, because I remember the last general was like 1.4 or somewhere in there. I mean, that's...
Yes, sir.
That's pretty amazing.
Yes, sir.
Was that mainly due to the Trump
Well, obviously that had something to do with it, but you also have to remember that, well, and the V helped us tremendously by allowing us to use your medium as a way to market what we're trying to do and encourage people to become registered and participate in the process. But we used a lot of different mediums throughout the state.
Sure.
We sent the mobile unit to all 67 counties at least one time in 2015 and 2016 to register people to vote and to make sure that we provided photo IDs. We had no incidences of occurrence in the March primary or in the general election or in any municipal contest where people denied access to the polls because they did not have a photo ID to participate in that process. So it's a confluence of things coming together all at one time. And when that happened, I was looking for George Clooney because it was obviously the perfect storm.
Yeah.
And it resulted in us breaking all of those records.
Well, that's fantastic. I mean, it was quite an election. We only got about 2 minutes. I want to talk about just a couple of things. There's been some problems with folks getting their payments due to the STARS accounting system. You and I have talked about that. We've talked to Clinton Carter, who's doing a good job over there. But you serve on the Board of Adjusters, or Adjustment.
Right.
And so how does that work?
Well, I've been chairman for the last year, and it's a rotating chairmanship. And Jim Ziegler will be our chairman for 2017. Young Boozer was the chairman when I took over. But I think it's important for Alabama citizens to know that that's the point of last resort that you can go to before you file a court case and sue the state trying to receive
right.
money that you're owed for services that you provided or
sure.
for something else that occurred. And I think many times people don't understand what that process is. And what we try to do in our office, and John Bennett, who's our deputy chief of staff, does a tremendous job in ensuring that people who are involved in our offices that might have claims or that call our office looking for information about how to solve their claims know what steps to take in order to have that payment made to them.
I was somewhere last week at a restaurant, and your commercial came on, and somebody who's not involved in politics was with us, and she said, "Why isn't he our governor?"
Oh, my goodness
gracious. Any plans for the future?
Well, people are so nice to say that. And, of course, I've had the privilege to visit all 67 counties for the last 4 years in a row. And in 2016, I made 350 unique visits to those 67 counties. And I'm always honored and humbled when people suggest that I might be an individual that should consider running for governor or running for another office. But this is what I believe. It's my job to do the best job I can in the position that the people have given me to serve them. And if they think I'm doing a good job at some point in the future, they'll encourage me to do something else. And if not, they'll send me back to 1549 Mallard Circle in Tuscaloosa, and I'll find something else to do.
Well, I hope they don't send you back. I hope they send you up.
Thank you.
We appreciate you being on the show with us today.
Thanks, Bill. It's always good to be here.
Thank you. You're watching The V, the voice of Alabama politics. Our guest today has been Secretary of State John Merrill. We'll be right back.
Azia Medical Spa offers a relaxing experience using customized skincare treatments and full line of physician-grade products with professionals that can assist you in determining which treatment options will best help you achieve your desired results. Azia's massage therapies are popular for rejuvenation and relaxation, as well as relief of tired, aching, and sore muscles. Voted the best medical spa in Birmingham for 3 years in a row, visit aziamedicalspa.com to schedule your appointment.
I'm John Merrill. When I became your Secretary of State in January 2015, we made a commitment to ensure that every eligible U.S. citizen that's a resident of our state is registered to vote and has a photo ID. Since that time, we've registered more than 600,000 new voters. And on November the 8th, we saw you at the polls. More than 2.1 million people, a record for our state, participated in the process. Now let's work together and let's make Alabama be the best that it can be.
Welcome back to The V, the voice of Alabama politics. There are beginning to be calls for the impeachment committee to reconvene. Jim Ziegler, of course, is called. Paul Beckman, Senator from Prattville, or Representative from Prattville, has called for it. I think, Claire, this all has to do with Luther Strange saying that there was no investigation. Well, they want to restart their impeachment.
Well, I mean, I'm not sure in what context the Attorney General said that, but we all know that there has been a grand jury going on in Montgomery County because y'all were down there. We had video of them coming in and out, so we know that's been going on. And I just think that Ziegler needs to take a chill pill. They all need to let the process, the due process with the legal system take its course before they start jumping. They got so many other things to worry about, this upcoming legislative session versus an impeachment.
Susan, do you really think there's any, this governor, after these appointments, he's not going to be relevant anyway, is he?
I don't think so. After he makes a sessions appointment and possibly the attorney general's appointment and this, you know, with the special election, I just don't think anybody's going to pay attention to him. They haven't for years to start with. Every budget that the legislature has ever gotten from him to start with, they've put in the garbage every year.
Well,
so why would that be different?
That's traditional.
Why would it be any different?
What do you think, Chip?
I have no idea. And I think the concern is that this investigation that we do or don't know is happening is going to run out before he gets out of office, and then there's not going to be any punishment for the things that
I think that's very likely.
Well, and I think the bottom line is, you know, they've been looking into wrongdoing, and they may not have enough information, really and truly, to get the governor
on
anything.
Well, he didn't steal any money.
He didn't steal anything. He didn't steal the State House,
But I think what needs to happen is Luther Strange, and we've emailed him about this, asked him for comment, asked him to clarify what he told Mike Kaysen at AL.com, and, you know, he told us, or his, you know, spokesperson said that he doesn't have any comment. Well, what I think needs to happen is what happened in the Spencer Collier case. If there's not an investigation, then the Attorney General needs to come out and say that there's not one.
Yes.
Just to clarify things. It's in the public interest, and that's usually their criteria.
Well, I mean, and Bentley's a pitiful man at this point.
There's
he's lost everything else.
Yeah,
there's a whole lot involved
in the next two weeks. Mm-hmm.
Well, something of a little political stew or, you know, whatever. Senator Phil Williams, affectionately known to all the senators as Niedermeyer from the Animal House movie, has a bathroom bill that he says has been misunderstood, and that you, Chip, did the best example of detailing the getting the truth out there as anybody else. So are there to be bathroom attendants or not?
That's the question. Senator Williams seems to think that there doesn't have to be an attendant at every bathroom. But his bill says otherwise. It says plainly in the law that there should be an attendant outside of every restroom making sure that it's being properly used. And he says that there's not, that you could just have a double-headed person, maybe somebody just at the office that can just address concerns if they ever arise from transgender individuals or from the people that are in the restroom.
So is Governor Powell going to jump out from behind a curtain and start yelling, citizens arrest, citizens arrest?
Well, I guess so, but the other interesting thing
How about cameras just on the outside of the doors, not inside the bathrooms, but on the outside?
How are you going to know? You're going to go up to somebody and go, I'm sorry, ma'am, you're going to have to lift your skirt.
This is Big Brother if I've ever seen it.
It's too much government intrusion in our lives. We want less as Republicans.
Yeah, I mean, just have one bathroom. Everybody stand on line. When you're out, the next person goes in.
As a woman, I take an exception
and
because of the way men keep their bathrooms.
Well, there's that. But the truth is, there's more evidence of Republican lawmakers doing mischief in bathrooms than there is of these pedophiles going after or transgender people. It's not transgender people. It's dirty old men live in trailer parks, sit there and watch porn all day.
Well, I think it's about 50-50 Republican, Democrat. You can't, you
well,
know,
I
mean,
know.
Whatever.
That wide stance seems to go very Republican. But anyway.
Okay, let's move on to the next one.
Y'all got off on a tangent there.
Just when it was getting fun. I want to do back up. We have to give Senator Sessions a lot of kudos. I think he did a great job.
Excellent
in the confirmation
job.
Hearings. I thought Cory Booker was absolutely dishonest in what he did. I didn't see
egregious.
Yeah, absolutely.
We listened to a lot of those hearings, big portions of those hearings and as we were traveling, and I just thought he did a really good job. Even when people like Al Franken tried to come after him, he stood his ground. He held to what he, you know, his beliefs were, and he wasn't shaken.
Well, he was very prepared, and you know, if anybody knows Jeff Sessions, I mean, he's a strong individual. He's got core beliefs, and he's not going to waver. And it, once again, as he told all these members on the Senate Judiciary Committee, you know, I'm not going to be in the Congress. I will be in the executive branch, and that's y'all's decision. And Jeff is going to always make sure that people follow the rule of the law.
I thought it was very interesting. This may be stagecraft, but every time there was a protester, he picked up the pitcher of water, poured him a glass of water, and drank it very calmly. I mean, that was pretty good. He did a good job.
Well, that gave him time for breathing. I mean,
well,
seriously.
It also diffused them. I think there were some protesters there in Ku Klux Klan outfits, from what I understand.
Mm-hmm. They're so fashionable. I think everyone will be wearing them soon.
Well, anyway,
well,
it's exciting.
It's exciting.
He did a great job. I look forward to having him as the Attorney General for the United States.
I do,
America.
Too. I think he's a fine man, and I hope his replacement will be Alabama-centric. I do want to talk about one thing. Josh Moon wrote a piece about gaming again this week and gambling and the various players, some judges who were over, you know, cases were taken away from them. Some indictments were made at the Attorney General's office. Those were taken away from him. But Claire, you brought up something even more interesting. That they, on what was it, Wednesday night?
Yeah, on the eve of a gambling task force to occur in Montgomery, there's these, I wouldn't say official raids, but all these state officials that went to all these facilities in Greene County counting their machines.
I mean, Susan, they even sent out a letter saying that
they did.
You know,
they sent out threatening letters to some of the vendors, even though they didn't bother to CC the attorneys for any of the people in Greene County. So, once again, are these threats, are they really planning on doing anything?
It's very suspicious.
It's very suspicious.
We got 20 seconds, Chip. Let the gambling commission come forward, right? Isn't that what we want to see?
I think so. We've got to do something. This debate has been going on in Alabama for decades, and if they don't just let the gaming commission do their job, then I don't think we're ever going
to
settle.
Well, ironically enough, I have to say this before. Beginning of the week, the word on the street was about the gaming commission was that the Indians put their foot down and said, we don't want any competition.
Well, I'm sure they don't. You've been watching the V, and we have no competition. You watch us, because we watch them.